So we welcome you for the third session of the day, and it is hands-on session because we thought like we are talking about data. We thought like we'll also give you an hands-on session. And before you start with this session, let me just give you some inputs. Do not worry that I don't know much of programming. Will it be too much syntax oriented? Will it be complicated? The idea of this session is to make you aware or understand what happens when there is huge data. So we are trying to take a simple data set and work on it. So if you are not able to go with the speed or with the flow, please do not hesitate. This is a small effort to expose you towards what R programming could be, because everybody is talking about data science today. So we need to understand what is data cleaning, data curation, data mining, data validation, everything about data, and how do people work on it. That's the small effort. So if you have installed the softwares, our expert will take you through step-by-step process of how to use, and take it slow. Now, with these sort of prelude, I welcome our professor, Dr. Naveen Paul, sir. Dr. Naveen Paul, sir, is a PhD in management from Kausali Institute of Management Studies, Karnataka University, Dharwad. Sir has also cleared some of the, eligibility tests, like Karnataka State Eligibility Test in 2015. Sir is also an MCOM from Kanakadasa College, Hubli. And he has done his MBA with specialization in marketing from Nitya Meenakshi Institute of Technology, Bangalore, under VTU. And now when you just look at the profile, you can also see like he comes with a good pack of 12 years of experience where he has worked in the FMCG and telecom sector. And talking about research, like it has been his, what you call as favorite or very interest areas of research he has done in terms when it comes to business analytics, statistics and research methodology. I have always seen, him sitting and working on the data, and that's how I understand him. So we call him as a data expert and data HOD. So sir also has 16 research articles in peer-reviewed journals at various UGC, UGC CARE listed and Scopus indexed publications, and also has a Google index of 16 citations followed with H index of 2 and I10 index of index 1, right? And 10 index 2, right? Okay. So, yeah. You can see he's also expert in SPSS, MOS, PLS, and R. And now we'll be talking about R. And he has done a certification course exclusively from Great Lakes on Python, Tableau, and Power BI. So, this is about, sir just requested me, not required to mention my personal details. Anyway, you're seeing it on the profile. So with all this information, I think it's going to be a great session. And I hope like you have all the documents installed. So let me introduce you to Dr. Naveen Paul, sir. So Naveen Paul, sir, we welcome you, sir. Over to you.
Thanks a lot, ma'am.
So thank you very much, ma'am, for your introduction. However, I don't find myself in that space wherein I can be called as, well-versed with R programming and all the stuff. I consider myself as a learner, and I always believe that there are either senior learners or junior learners. And we always, data science or data analytics is such a big field that we happen to know one thing, and then we realize that, there is so much to learn way ahead. Having said that, I'll just quickly share my PPT, ma'am. It's visible, ma'am?
Yes, sir.
Okay. Very good afternoon to everybody. Today I would be sharing my thoughts or also my understanding on data mining. And I'll just make an attempt to introduce all of them to the one of the very popular programming language, which is R programming, which is gaining a lot of traction these days. And this would be the content of this session. So So I'll just briefly take you through. It's like concept wise, what is business analytics? Pragmatically, how I see that, rather than telling that how it is being derived. Then what are the different types of business analytics? What prevails today? Then there is also a very popular vicious model that they call, which is Crisp DM in analytics. So that I will just share my thoughts on that. Then brief about what is actually a data mining. Then what are the different supervised or unsupervised machine learning techniques that are very much popular in data mining techniques. Then we'll just have a bit of a hands-on session. And I assume that some of them, they would not be having a pre-knowledge about what are programming and how does it look. So keeping that thing into perspective, I'll just happen to show you like how the R window looks like and what are the different components into that. Then once we just go ahead, the term probably would be aware, because I can see there are so many doctors in the this thing probably. And from the as I told that we there are always learners and senior learners. I consider myself as a learner, and I always welcome some insights. And from every session or is from every class, I always get some of the other learnings. So here, I'm also to percolate what I know and also to receive like what you guys can give to me also. And then we will also look upon, if time permits, then what is the KNN model, Naive Bayes, and LDA. So how can a given set of problem, how these three models will work, and which could be the best model when we compare. So this is how I understand business analytics as a concept. Now it's all about we have been sharing thoughts from the previous resource persons, and they've been telling us world is obsessed with the data, and there is so much of technology which is coming into picture. So now in business analytics, the data, it always comes into raw format. And what an business analyst or also data scientist does is like he converts a raw data into an information. For example, there is a website called as Kaggle, and there what is happening is now there's data is not scarce these days, and the companies which cannot afford to hire a data scientist or a data analyst, so they happen to share their data in that particular website. And many people who are interested or else who want to play around with the data happen to log in, and they basically fiddle around with the data and they suggest a few changes. And whichever is the best suggested answer will be rewarded. So that is how it works. So fundamentally, what I'm trying to tell you is any raw, like the data, it comes into a raw format. And basically, the information are been retrieved from that, patterns are been drawn, and more of a descriptive analysis is done, then followed by exploratory data analysis. Then a lot of pinch of inferential statistics and machine learning algorithms will be added, and conclusions would be derived. So basically, if I have to talk, like data, as you all know, like it is either a by large, it is either a qualitative data or it's a quantitative data. And qualitative data, it is majorly in the form of text, which comes to us, or else into a voice format, or else into a video format. So now in current scenario, because of social media being so much predominant, and the major data which comes, like 70% of data, it is qualitative in nature, and then followed by a quantitative data. And qualitative data, it is gaining lot of popularity, and analysis like be it sentiment analysis or else text analysis or else word cloud computing. So all these things are getting a lot of importance these days. And and further quantitative analysis, if I have to talk about it, is either an categorical data in nature or else either it's a continuous data. So by large, a quantitative data can be either a categorical or is a continuous data. So this is the particular website that I was talking about. And from here, we can access n number of data sets, and we can observe that maximum of the data, it would be raw in nature. For example, initially we need to compute it in Excel, or else directly you can import it in R or Python, and you can play around. But initially, what I do is like I download that data, and I happen to, for example, is a particular like competition. They have competitions also, I guess. For example, this is one of the data set, and you can see word prices are also been mentioned. In case if you come up with a rational output, and if you happen to send back, if they find it very viable, so there's a very good chance of you winning this. Yeah, and for example, I was talking about data. Too many data sets are there that you can happen to see here. Like for example, this is one data set on women entrepreneurship. Like for example, this all once you download it, actually you need to divide those data into different cells. However, I think so you can just fiddle around with these things, and I happen to see this particular data. So that is what I was telling you, and you can see here there's a credit card customers data, wherein actually you can download this data, and you can predict whether a customer is likely to default his repayment or no. So all those things, and you can see an interesting data here, which is IPL data set, wherein it has got the data of 2008 to 2020. This actually they had run a context also, wherein in the recent IPL which team is going to win. So all so based on the analysis, this particular context was been run. So multiple things happen here. You can see Netflix data is also there. So coming back to the presentation part. So now analytics is all about when data gets synced. I'm going to say then we happen to play around with the data using statistics. And nowadays it is more of rather than descriptive, it is more of exploratory data analysis, wherein we try to find that. So meanwhile, in my presentation, when I happen to go to R program, so I'm just a simple example of what, and then we also happen to go ahead with inferential statistics, wherein we take a sample data from a sample, and we derive a conclusion for the entire set of population. And to these wonderful activities, we take assistance from analytical tools, and all this time Java was there, C++ were there, and slowly, losing a bit of insight, or else people have started to move towards R or else Python, and now SQL was actually leading a couple of years back, but slowly Python has taken over. Initially, R took over. And now it's like Python is the market leader when it comes to open source. And normally R and Python, we do have free versions, which actually provides all the major computations. But some of them are there, which are into paid versions. And those things have been used predominantly by companies. And nowadays, if I have to tell, like data visualization is also gaining too much of attention. Happening like there is something called as interactive dashboards, wherein if you change one particular option, that entire set of data which is linked with that, be it pie chart, bar charts, or else histograms, all everything changes. So those things, and you can also connect a live data with these particular softwares, and you can see how actually the data varies. Like as in when the trends of the data varies, then automatically the output also changes. So that is how these things enable, and this is getting lot of importance. And Power BI is one, which is also in the leap. However, I think so it's not here. And Power BI is also becoming very popular. But now, if you can see for all the statistical tools, Excel still acts as a very effective tool, I can say, okay, for data analysis. And if I have to talk about the type of business analytics, so as we told descriptive, wherein actually you tend to find the patterns in the data. For example, if I've got people who come to bank to take loans. So what is the demographic profile of them? Okay. What is the geographical location from where they come from? What is their income? So basically, they tend to understand the demographic profile of that particular customer. So and they are, this just provides a description of a data. Then further, hypothesis testing, which is one of the major tool or statistical analysis when it comes to business analytics, and that we call it as a diagnostic analysis. Then after that, we also have a predictive analysis, wherein a combination of a historic data, which is continuous data, or is a combination of continuous and categorical data, which helps us to predict the future. Now, people like normally it is a wrong notion that prediction can happen just like that, but it's it needs action. It's not that 100% the prediction would be right. In case if any of the models are predicting the output 100% accurate, then that is actually called as an overfit model. There has to be testing, trial and test, which has to happen. So, and it's helping us to solve a particular business problem. And whether there is an aspect of a type 1 error or type 2 error, so that is basically we talk about, it talks about a prescriptive analysis as such. Now, this is one fundamental vicious circle of business analytics. Like, for example, data when it comes to you, okay? And there is also a concept called a GIGO. I mean, this is just a jargon what they use into data science, that garbage in and garbage out. For example, these statistical softwares, so they don't have that capability of understanding how the data exactly is. So for them, just numbers is numbers. So it's we have to decide what is the right data set that we have to. So what is the right data set that we have to feed in the software? So it's like if we feed in an junk data, the software will just give a junk output. So that is what has happened. So for that, basically a business understanding is also very important aspect. For example, if anyone knows coding, that does not mean that that particular person can solve any sort of a problem in given set of scenario, right? And for example, FMCG sector, a person who is working in FMCG sector or else who knows the nuances of the business can understand the data which is applicable to that particular sector. Okay, if I bring someone from an automobile sector or else an construction industry, probably those people would not be able to understand that data set. And what is next is required that we need to understand is basically the nature of the data. So whether a data or else a combination of data, whether they are categorical in nature or else a continuous in nature. And so this is the most important part, what comes when it comes to business analytics or else data analytics. So many of them, they would be having a wrong notion that, all the time the data analyst will be sitting and doing models and they'll be like, predicting outputs. It's not true. So 80% of the time it goes into data cleaning or data cleansing, wherein they try to draw the patterns or and they'll try to get rid of the junk data. And in the current scenario, we are talking about big data. And to treat those big data, it requires lot of time and effort, and effort which will not be uniform. It will be a collective effort from a team, and the maximum time it goes into this. And then comes the model building, and we do a predictive analytics. So as per my knowledge, you know, some of the basic things if you have to know about predictive modeling, it just runs about one or two lines of codes, and the maximum 70 to 60% of the codes are run in performing the you know, the loading of the file, or is performing the exploratory data analysis and trying to understand whether there is a lot of variance in the data, and if there is a variance, what test has to be you know, applied for that. And depending on the output, whether it's a continuous data output I want, or it's a categorical I want, whether I want to go ahead with logistic regression or a linear discriminant analysis. So all those things will come into picture. Then we basically do a modeling, and we happen, and it's not that, you know, for a given data set, we happen to do a particular model. So we can run 2 to 3 different set of models for a data set. And we and the data set can be divided into a train and test data set. Basically, in case if a train data set is giving one output and test data set is giving the other, that means there is some issue with the data set, or else the sample size is not adequate. Okay. And evaluation happens. For example, model comparison happens. What a logistic regression is able to give me an output, and what a linear discriminant analysis is able to give me an output, or else KNN, or else Naive Bayes. So different models are there. So what models exactly, you know, are able to predict the results accurately? Okay. So based on that, the evaluation happens, and further, this thing is being given to you know, the deploying of the software in a server. Okay, so this is basically how the field of data analysis, also data mining as a structure, it happens. Okay, and data mining. So this is an hierarchy that is very much popular. However, there are multiple other tests, and I have just put the tests which are of more importance or else of high relevance. So data mining, or else machine learning algorithms, it can be broadly classified into supervised and unsupervised learning techniques. So supervised learning techniques is where there, you know, that we have got X variables and we predict the Y. Okay. So for example, in case a customer like footfalls, how many customers are coming, and what is like in case, and the way his behavior is, and whether based on that sort of a behavior, whether he is probable, the probability of making a purchase or not making a purchase. So Y is like a dependent variable wherein he will purchase or no. So that particular thing will be predicted. And unsupervised learning techniques are basically wherein there is no existence of Y in the structure. The only X's are there. For example, if I have to talk about like grouping of the data happens. Okay, market basket analysis. For example, now in case if a guy goes to a supermarket, he's picking bread, and then he's taking eggs also. Then there is a high probability that the model predicts that he might take jam as an option also, or else a mayonnaise sauce also. So that is how the market basket analysis works. Okay, and now I will be talking in this session about the dimension reduction aspect. And that is majorly like I will be covering on the aspect of what is factor analysis and what is principal component analysis. And however, I have got a strong feeling that many of you know the concept of dimension reduction. But however, I'll just like to try to share my viewpoints on that, and we'll just fiddle around in our software. Okay. So initially, so let's have a few insights on our programming language. So I'll just happen to open and I'll just share the screen.
Shared.
Okay. So this is how an R Studio looks like. Okay. So basically, R programming was been developed by two scientists. Two researchers. And further, it was been observed that a lot of coding has been done. And now in coming days, it's more about clicks also. So keeping those things into mind, RStudio has been developed. And whatever you do in R, it can also be done in R Studio. That's the reason I am showing you R Studio. However, it is said that, you know, if you don't have R programming being installed, you cannot install R Studio. That's the reason I have sent you two different links. And, you know, initially you have to download R, and the latest version is 4.0.3. And that is the version which we are supposed to download. And if we end up downloading a older version, then there are multiple packages which will not you know, run, or else which cannot be executed in this. So this is basically how a structure of R looks like. That's what I was telling about. You know, initially when you happen to download an R Studio, it looks something like this, and there are four different quadrants. Okay, so this is the place where, you know, we happen to write any of the program. For example, like if I have to write something. Okay, so for example, let me put a simple number, 50 plus 50. So 50 plus 50. And I hit a control enter, okay, and the output would be visible here. Okay, so basically this is called as a console, wherein the output is visible. And to clear all the information, control L is the short key, control L. So I'll just happen to run this again. Okay, so you can see here. Okay, so this is the output. So this is just a fundamental understanding, so kindly just don't go by what am I typing here. Okay, or else you can just, you know, select this particular thing and you can happen to run it also, right? Or else if you can just place your cursor here and you can run it also. So it depends up to you. Why we do a selection? Because in case if you've got n number of codes, and if I have to run a selected set of codes, then we happen to select it and we happen to run it. Okay, so that is what it happens. And and in case if I'm not happy with the layout of the R window, so there is a nice option that, you know, it's been said that it has been added in the recent versions. Like I can go to the option of tools, and I can go to option of global options. Right. So once I click this, this particular window opens up. Then you can see here the appearance. Okay. So if I go to appearance, and you can see here, like the moment I change all these things, so the outlook of the window also changes. For example, if I'm going to say, if I happen to select twilight, okay, you can see here. So this is how my window is going to be. So actually, I happen to I prefer cobalt. So this is one cobalt that actually normally I prefer it, because it has got some blue background and all the codes will be properly highlighted. Then you also have got the option of changing the text, like as we have got in MS Word. So these things are there, and you can also increase or decrease the font size. So I'll just apply this, and I'll just click OK. So this looks better for me. Okay, that that you can access with this tools and global options, and you can go to the appearance part and you can change it. Okay, yeah. And rest of the things which happens to fall in this toolbars are like quite simple, and it's actually self-explanatory. For example, if I go to file and if I have to open a new script, right? And there is also option of edit, wherein conventional cut, copy, paste, and all those things we have got. So basically all these things, and these things also happen to fall here also. For example, plots, you can see here plots are there. So whatever I do, the plots will come here. And in case if I have to download some of the packages, so there is an option of installing packages. And in case if I want some help, like for example, there is a package called as Tidyverse. So I can put a question mark and I can just do a control enter. Might take some, because so there is a bit of lag in the net, I think. So there's a bit of issue. No, okay. Probably my system has become a bit slow. Okay, so like this, like for example, if you want to know something about Tidyverse, or else if you want to know about what is a t-test, we can know like how, like in case if I have to run a t-test, so basically what is the program that follows? So we'll just touch upon these things also. So basically the major intent was to tell you like it helps also, like it's not that, you know, all the time we have to memorize the codes, because there will be n number of codes and we cannot memorize each and everything. So this always comes for a rescue. So I'll just start with a few of the introductory commands, like I showed you 50 plus, I'm going to say 50 plus 50, and just assume that, you know, there's a 25 plus 25 and I happen to do this. And there is something called as a vector. For example, this particular thing, I need not have to tell that, you know, every time if I want an output for 25 plus 25, I need not have to write this. So for example, I can assign as a vector. For example, I tell that a is equal to 25 plus 25, and I do this, and you can see a new vector is being created. Okay, so there is a or else an object, if I have to call, there is an object being created, and next time I need not have to do anything, I just have to type a, and if I do a control enter, my output will be visible. Okay, so this is a basic thing, but it is very effective. So just for example, in case if you are writing n number of codes, okay, a lengthy code, but for the entire code you can assign a simple, okay, like for example a simple vector a, or else any nomenclature that you want, you can just assign it, okay, and you can just retrieve an output, either you can directly type the vector name, or else you can also for some functions print comes into handy. So there is an option of print. So for example, the same thing, why am I saying it's the same thing? Because, you know, it's so flexible, that's the reason it is called as a language, because to retrieve one particular thing, there is not a particular set of codes. It is so flexible that, for example, if I have to execute and program like factor analysis, there are different types of codes that we can run, and still we end up getting the same result or as output. Okay, so for example, for addition, this is the thing, and multiplication, I guess I need not have to tell, but just for the sake of explanation, I'll just put it. Kindly don't think otherwise, that simple things I'm just putting it. So for example, just 125 to 5, I can get the output, or else I've just created a vector for this. And in case if I have to clear this, the control L is the option, like I told, but it will not change anything. Now I have created a vector and I'm just going to hit it. So you can see here the simple option of multiplication is also being implemented, right? In the same way, in case if I have to do a division also, for example, C is equal to if I have to use 256 divided by 16. And if I happen to see what is C, so my output is got. So these are some of the very, very, very fundamental, or it's a basic option. Kindly don't think otherwise. Slightly, we'll just go ahead. And for example, if I want to repeat, okay, so if I want to repeat a certain set of values, for example, I'll just type R. This is a vector, okay, it can be anything, you can write your own name also. For example, I'll just write Rohan. It doesn't actually impact anything. You can write Rohan, R, or anything of your choice. For example, this, and I'll just type REP, correct? And I'll just open the parenthesis, and I'll just ask R to repeat digit 3 for 50 times, okay? So the moment I do this, and I happen to, as I told you, Rohan, I can also select it and I can run it. Now we can see the three digit has been repeated 50 times. Okay. And in case if I want to, and we also have got a sequence, for example, S. Okay. So for example, S, and I have got a sequence, and I just ask a number from 0 to 100, 0, 0, 100, and there should be a differentiation by 2, okay, by 2. It just gives me a sequence. And see, so a sequence of a 0 to 100, and it has to be divided by 2. So basically, there is a differentiation of 2. However, I have always got an option of changing this. And let me put like this also. You can see here, it changes accordingly. Okay. So this is one set of further set of program. So these are some of the very fundamental programs. I mean, it's not program actually. Some commands that I have told you, and slightly we will just raise the bar, and we will just create a vector. Create a vector, or else we'll just use combine. Okay, there is a key of combine that we'll use. So why have I put a hash is because this does not mean anything for R. This is just the heading for R. So for example, if I have to run this, you know, the same thing comes. If, for example, if I put a hash, and if I have to, if I'm putting, for example, square root, for example, if I'm putting square root of 289, and if I'm doing this, so it will not run, okay? Because I have put a hash, right? So hash does not mean anything. So it is just an heading in R, and just in case if this is there, for example, SQ. Okay, I'm just doing this now, and if I happen to write SQ now, and if I see, okay, so output is coming. So why I showed you this is because whenever you put a hash, so whatever is there following that, it just gets nullified. It just becomes a title. Okay, so I'll just delete this. Just wanted to show you. So hash, using hash, we can put a heading in R. Okay, so now it's always better to create an error. So just to do a fundamental error initially. For example, if I have to have a data, okay, a combination of a series of data, and for example, if I have to have 2 and 5 and 1 and 7 and 10 and 3 and 50. Okay, so this is a set of data. For example, I want to have a series of data as a part of a data frame, or else it should be a series of data which has to be there for me. But what happens is like the and I'm creating a vector, but if I do a control enter, so it tells that there is an error. And how exactly we are supposed to create a particular line of data is like, for example, W is equal to, there is an option of combine. So R is case sensitive. So a small c you can use, which basically tells combine. And I'll just, happen to copy this. This, and I'll just, create it. And now I can see if I run this W, now I can see, okay, so for me, W is this series of data. So basically, I am trying to create a series of data using this C as an option. Okay. So likewise, I can also assign, this is about a numerical data. For example, if I want to know the class of W, so that is a numeric data for me. Okay. So what is the nature of the data? That also tells. Now, for example, if I have to have a categorical data, okay, for example, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 7 are there. For example, if I want to have a categorical data, so all the categorical data have to come into inverted commas. So for example, this, I'll write it as Virat, then Rohit, then Just one second. Sometimes it happens. I have not closed this. Okay. That's the reason it was not coming. So I'm just type. Okay, yeah. So this is how I can assign value basically non-numeric in nature. And if I have to see the class, if I just have to see the class of U, what it is, it will show a character. Okay. And if I have to combine both the things, okay, and if I have to create a data set, for example, I have to create a matrix or else a data frame wherein both the things exist simultaneously. So I can create something called as a data frame, and how it looks as, for example, I'll just name it as a data frame for the convenience, and is equal to for example data data dot frame is the command. You can see here the moment I type it, this particular option pops in. So data dot frame, and I want both the things, right? So I'm correct, it is a small w and a capital U I have put, right? Okay. So data frame has been created. So this is particularly an object, and if I happen to run this object, now we can see a particular data set has been created. Okay, so w, I mean, say okay, let's assume that this w is wickets been taken. Okay, wickets been taken by Virat Kohli, one other time he would have bowled, and Rohit Sharma and Dhoni, Ishant, okay, something like this. Okay, so I can create a data frame like this. So this particular command is for data, creating a data frame, data dot frame, right? Okay. And now, in case I was talking about outlier, so before going into a factor analysis and telling how outlier is, and there is a very good chance that you can go mistry, like you might not happen to gauge the concept properly. For example, now this set of a code I had, right? So this set of a code I had, okay? So now here, by just looking at the numbers, I can tell that probably 50 is one which is on the very higher side, or else 2 is very lower side. But I have got subsequent numbers which are very, I mean, say substantiating this. So the difference as such is not too high, but 50 might be an outlier. So this is for a small data set. Just imagine if I've got a 1 lakh or also 10 lakh data sets, so it becomes difficulty for us to identify these sort of outliers, and it's always better to get rid of such data. For example, if I want to see graphically a graphical representation of an outlier, the simple best way of seeing that is box plot analysis. So box plot, I want a box plot to be plotted here, and the outlier should be shown there. So if I do a box plot and if I do a W, right? So you can see here, just one second. Okay, now we can see here that this is a box plot. However, in case if it is not that good, then always we have got an option. I'll just make it horizontal. Horizontal is equal to true. Then if I want, I can put some colors also. Color is equal to let me put red. However, there are okay, sorry, my bad. Yeah, this looks a bit better. Now you can see so now it is telling that any data set between 1 and probably 11 or 12, these are the best data sets, and anything beyond this is an outlier. And this basically box plot, if I have to put it in nutshell, so this is a median, and these are the next 25% of the data, and this is the next 25% and this is 25 and this is 25. So basically, this is a interquartile range and this is a outlier. For example, in the entire set of data, so this one point is an outlier which can, you know, affect my model when I predict an output, right? So this is one way of identifying. So there is a point, but how do I need to identify whether, like, which is the particular number or else where does it stand? So I can just, you know, type out, I can just type outlier and equals to, I'll just happen to copy the same thing and I'll just paste it here and I'll just do a control enter and I'll run this same vector. The moment I do this, okay, so you can see here OUT out. So it is telling that in the cell one, okay, however, we have got only one cell and this particular number is an outlier, okay. So going ahead, we can get rid of this particular data. So this is a very, very, very small example that I'm telling. So you might feel that, you know, it's just not that relevant, but going ahead, just imagine the same thing if I do for a larger data set, it looks even the more effective. Okay. Then, straightly, let's jump towards the concept of factor analysis. I think so this would be sufficient in explaining you the fundamental aspects of R programming, like just to re-narrate some of the few things. And the major emphasis is on a vector, so or else an object, if I have to tell. So you can tell it as an object. So any set of functions you can assign as an object and you can perform n number of equations or else functions. And next time, if you just happen to run that particular object, automatically you will retrieve an output. Okay. And this is how you are supposed to create an combination of numbers or as a character. Then both of them together, if you want to have, it can be called as a data frame. Okay, so that also can happen, right? So yes, so these are the few things that we have done. Now, just let me quickly, you know, go through the concept of factor analysis. So just before that, I'll just share the PPT again and try to discuss with you the concept of factor analysis. And if anyone has got even the more insights on that particular concept, are always open to share. So I was basically telling that, you know, there's a concept of factor analysis which is broadly been used to combine the different data sets. Okay. So for example, you have got data in rows. However, I'll show you a data set. Then I will tell you how basically it works. So try to stick with for further few more minutes. And in this presentation also, we will try to understand what is the prerequisites for a factor analysis and what is the aspect of multicollinearity and what is an eigenvalue. And factor rotation, like basically it happens in the back end of a statistical programming language. So how basically the software tries to understand or is derive pattern from the data, okay? And what is the factor aspect of commonality and uniqueness? Basically these all things I'll try to make an attempt to discuss with you with an case study which is being used in one of the books which I'll show you. So first things first, what is a factor analysis? So as I told you, it just happens to combine few of the data points. For example, if we go to a restaurant, right? So if I go to a restaurant, then there is something called as a waiting time. Like I order for an for a dish and I've got a waiting time. So, and then how the particular person who is a waiter, how does he behave with me? Then what is the, you know, ambience? How does it look like? Then how is the card service? Like once I happen to take the food and once I'm giving the check, then how the card service happen. So all these things, so and just trying to put some of the variables, but there will be n number of variables. Okay. So all this, for example, if I'm taking a response from say 1 to 7, okay, on a scale of 1 to 7, I take all these responses. Then somewhere I can tell that all these things can be told as a service, right? So in spite of me, asking someone how is the service, because this cannot be measured by large, as one variable, because there are multiple antecedents which are been attached to this, or as a parameters which are attached to this. So service as a variable, I cannot measure this directly. So that's the reason when I have to measure service, I need to collapse this, or else I need to take responses pertaining to these particular antecedents. Then I have to collapse these variables, or else I have to just sum it up. So whatever is the output, I need to sum it up. Then I can frame a variable, right? Later, depending on the nature of the study, I can decide whether this is an independent variable or is a dependent variable, right? So similarly, one more example of that, financial security, standard work, working hours, then equal treatment at the workplace, then the ability of Gravian cell, how it is basically performing. So I take responses pertaining to these things, then I add up all the responses, and I can tell that I can measure a variable called as happiness at workplace. Because this particular variable, by nature, it is a latent variable, which cannot be measured directly, right? So for example, so this is one thing. So this is a very, very simple example that I'm trying to showcase to you. Just imagine there's a complicated, there are too much of complicated variables. Like for example, many of you are doctorate and you know it very well that in a questionnaire, for example, scaled data you are taking, and you are trying to understand the consumer behavior, which normally nowadays don't, many of them, they don't prefer to study that much. So in case if I got a series of elements running, right? And those series of elements, 70 to 80 elements are there, or 70 to 80 questions are there. I cannot, measure or evaluate each and every question individually. For example, this individually, I cannot check its relationship with the dependent variable. Just imagine if I've got 100 to 150. That's the reason we need to, find variables which are, they do have little bit of a proximity with each other. And these variables combined together will form a latent variable, right? So this is the fundamental aspect of factor analysis. Okay. I know many of you would be knowing, then also it's just an that thought of having a refresh on that, right? Okay. Then why it is used, as I told you, to collapse the data. Okay. And furtherly, majorly, in case if you have got an dependent variable further in your study, for example, service is there, and the type of service, what it is happening, and next, okay, that you are recommending to others, right? So you are spreading of word of mouth, or else you becoming loyal, okay? Depending on the service, you become loyal to that particular restaurant, or else you spread word of mouth. That becomes a dependent variable. So basically, that we can evaluate through a regression analysis going ahead. So factor analysis acts as a foundation to compute a multivariate regression analysis going ahead. Okay. So that is why it is largely been used, and it addresses the aspect of multicollinearity. Okay. So what are the prerequisites for factor analysis? So the prerequisite is like the data should be normally distributed. So whatever is my independent variables or is the residual of the data, they are required to be continuous in nature, and they have to be normally been distributed. Okay, so that is where we check the normality of the data using MVN. Okay, multivariate normality. There is a package in R, so that is how we check. In case if the data is not normally distributed, we need not have to worry. So the further we can compute a factor analysis, provided we convert the non-normal data to normality using a Boxcox lambda. So there is an option. Yes, ma'am. Okay. So fine. So there is an aspect of Boxcox lambda, right? And So for example, in the variables what I showed, for example, I have taken a scale of 1 to 7. Just imagine if I have, and the data sets are uniform in nature, 1 to 7. Just imagine if I'm taking income as one parameter, and one more parameter is the scale, scaled data. But both the things, both the variables in magnitude wise, they're very much different. They're not uniform. That is where this scaling comes into picture. Okay. This further, I'll just show you in the further example also. So basically scaling, we do either through computing Z-scores or is through min-max method. Okay, the concept of scaling is what we were discussing. I'll just make you clear with further with an example. Okay. So this is a very, very small example proposed by a professor, okay, F.C. Brown, a professor in marketing research, Wharton Business School, in his book, Research Methodology. So he has put this small case. Okay. So wherein there are different elements, and basically they use those elements to know the performance of a salesperson, okay, salesforce performance. Then a particular employee, he tells that rather than having a different set of variables, can we combine few variables and call it as one variable? Okay. So for example, this is a small data set. This is what has been shared. So we have got height of a salesperson, weight of a salesperson, his education qualification, his age, number of dependent children, how many children does he have, then size of the household, then what is his IQ level. Okay. So by looking, okay, just to crack the nut in advance, I can tell that height and weight can be combined as one variable. Okay. So because it has got to do something with fitness, that I can tell. Okay. Then education qualification, then it can be related to the IQ level. Okay. So somewhere I can tell that higher the education, the better would be the IQ level. It's my assumption, right? So these two can go well together. Then further, age and probably number of children, what they have, and the size of the household. Probably these three data, or somewhere, number of children and size of household. So somewhere either these three data put together points, or else a combination of two can go together. So overall, I can tell that, roughly that there can be a three different constructs, like I showed you the service quality, like that, a latent variable, like that there can be three different latent variables in this case, right? So how we will go ahead with this problem in understanding which are the variables which can be collapsed together, how can we have an understanding? So what is the process to look at that using our software? So basically, initially we will load a few packages. For example, for factor analysis, there are few packages that we have to load. Like I was telling about Tidyverse, and there is FA factors, and there is a psych package. And to plot few things, we have got summary tools and ggraph tools. So that we will discuss. So we will load few packages. Then we will just do some data summary. We'll just see from some summary tools package. Then we'll do a data exploration of the data. We'll do some exploratory data analysis, whether the data has got any outliers, and is the data normally been distributed, or else is there any multicollinearity issue, right? And we will see the correlation aspect also. Then further, once we enter into the aspect of factor analysis, initially to do factor analysis, we have to go with the KMF test, and to do a PCA, which is called as a principal component analysis, we need to do a Bartley's test. So these two things we will just happen to see. Then we will see what is an eigenvalue, how much it is. Okay. This we will just discuss. Okay. Then we'll plot that eigenvalue. So basically I'm just telling you the flow of the analysis, how it can be done. And there is a concept of rotation and non-rotation, which basically works in the background. And then we will also, once factor analysis we have done, we'll do the same thing using principal component analysis also. Okay. Then finally, we will check the aspect of multicollinearity. So before, was there any correlation? Then after executing the model, is there any correlation still existing? So one fundamental aspect I just wanted to discuss, that rotation, how it works in the background. For example, in case if this is the spread of the data, and this is the, you know, one particular variable that you have, and the data points which are having close proximity, okay, and this can be called as a signal which have got a close proximity. So this basically is an understanding on linear regression also, okay. So the data points which are having the least errors and the best line which fits in, okay, so that is termed as the linear regression. Then we basically have got the outliers which is called as the noise, and in case if to happen one more line or else a variable coming into picture, then that would be somewhere difficult to tell that whether this particular data it goes well with this or else this particular variable. So it becomes difficult. So that's the reason how factor analysis works is like, it assumes like this, and once we go on proposing multiple number of variables, multiple lines are been drawn, and basically a concept of iteration or its rotation happens. For example, whichever the data are falling between these two lines with maximum number of rotations are been captured, and they will be termed as having a close proximity. Okay, so I'll just go to the R programming. And we'll just quickly so to load any of the files in R programming, for example, that I showed you in the data set how it looks like, height, weight and all, it basically had 14 observations, and the same data set I do have in an CSV file also. So before that, we need to set a working directory. In R, working directory fundamentally tells is like, whatever output we get, where am I supposed to save, or else whichever file I have to load, from which destination I have to load it. So that's the reason I need to set a working directory. So set working directory, WD is the command for that, and I just have to open the inverted commas and go to the URL, okay, or is the the path, okay, where my file exists, and I have to just copy that and I have to just paste it. Okay, so this is the path where my file is actually. So ABBS AICT, then this is the address of that. So whatever are the flower slashes, I need to convert into the blackbird slashes. Okay, so this is one way of loading a file, which is a basic option that I am showing you. Okay, so once I do this, okay, your working directory has been set. Then if I have to see whether it is properly done or not, so get working directory is one more option. And yeah, so basically I have set a working directory, so henceforth whatever output I will be doing, it will go and save in this particular destination, or as wherever I have to retrieve the file, it will retrieve from that particular destination. Okay, or else I can also go to the import file, so this is the better option. Okay, and you can see here from Excel or else from text, okay, whichever way, okay, SPSS and strata files, whatever files you have got, you can happen to read from that also, right? Okay, so rather than that, I'll just prefer the writing a command. So this is the basic thing, why people practice this is to have a good hand over the programming language. Okay, so I'll just name it as my data. So by this time I'm sure that you understand what is a vector. Okay, so as you, if you can recapitulate, we were talking about this A, B, C. So these are basically vectors that we have created. Similar way, I'm creating a vector or an object. So this can be of anything. Okay, so this is up to your discretion. So I'm just naming it as my data one, rather than keeping it as my data. I'm just keeping it as my data one, and for that I'll just happen to read and my file is a CSV file, and I'll just go to the file. The name of the file is PCA-brown, and the nature wise it is a CSV file, and I'll just, you know, turn that. If I do this also, the file will be loaded. Okay, you can see the file is loaded. However, there is a practice that, you know, it carries heading. Header is equal to true. Either you can type true, or else T is also true. T also would suffice. So by doing this, I have successfully loaded the file. Okay. For example, if I have to see here, I happen to run this my data. Okay, it's here. You can see here, the file is successfully been loaded. Okay. So once I have loaded the file, then I'll just name it as loading of file. And once I've loaded the file, so I'll just install some of the packages which are very much relevant for factor analysis. Loading or installation of packages. Okay. So multiple packages, we can load it like this. We can use the option of a Pacman, wherein we have got p_load, and I'll just load some of the packages. Like for example, I've got summary tools, which comes very handy. Then I have got tidyverse. Let me not take tidyverse for this. Let me take Psyche. Factor analysis, Psyche is very, then we have got n factors. Factors, and then we have got I need to do some graphical representation, then I'll just use QGGraph. Okay, I think so that would suffice. And in case now it is taking a bit of time, and this red button tells that, you know, we need to wait for some time. Meanwhile, it, in case if some of the packages are not loaded, it will load, or else in case if it is already been loaded and there in the system, it will bring from the back end to the front end, so that, you know, it will be there. Like whenever we are running that, it will be there in the back end. So for me, because I had installed it previously, so these packages are very much there in the system. Okay, so these two things are a bit necessary, or is vital initially. Okay, you might feel a bit lost, but just trust me. Once you happen to get used to these packages, and time and again, recollecting these things won't be difficult. Okay, and any spaces also doesn't matter. Okay, fine. Now, in case if I have to view that data, for example, now view is one option. There are two things, but I'll use this view, and I'll just use my data. Because I have saved this as a my data vector. Okay, so I'll just we'll just view this. Now you can see the same data set what I have shown you in the PowerPoint presentation. The same data set is here, and it's a small data set with the 14 observations, right? Okay. And how many set of columns are there? 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, and 8. We can see, you know, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8. 8 different observations are there. For example, person. This is nothing but the serial number. And this is, I was discussing the height and weight, education, qualification, age, number of children, household size, and IQ. Okay. So these are the different data points, or else observations that we have. Okay. Yeah. So, and in case if you want to see, because we have installed this summary tools as a package, then we can also view it in a different way. Summary tools is the option. Okay, so summary tools, then I can see it as a view df summary, and the name of the file is my data one. Okay, it will take some time. Now the same thing, okay, same thing, but a few more options are been added. For example, the person, now we can say it's an integer in nature, but the minimum value is 1 and maximum value is 14. However, I have got 14 observations. That means it's a serial number, okay. Then height I have got, okay. However, this has it has been distributed, okay. And this is the distribution. By large, it looks like a normal distribution for me. So if you can recapitulate on the aspect of normality, so I can tell that this data is normally distributed. Even this is normally distributed. Somewhere this is near to normality, but I have got a bit of concern. So let us say that. This also looks a bit okay. Number of children, certainly not that normally distributed. Yeah, this is normally, and this is also normally distributed. Okay, yeah. So this particular option of summary tools will enable me in viewing the data even the more better. Okay. Then quickly I will just check the aspect of multicollinearity, for which I have got option of correlation analysis. So simple thing, I'll just quickly run a correlation test. For example, I will name it as I'll create a vector by the name correlation. Let me create a vector by correlation. I'll just create a vector by the name correlation. However, the function is COR. COR. Okay, COR core. You can see here. Then I'll just do it on. Okay, now let me run this. Now we can see. Oh, okay. So the person thing, I think so. I need to get rid of this because it's just a nominal data for me. So what I will do is I'll create one more vector by name. My data is equal to let this come as a let it be like my data one, and I'll take out first column because it is first. So this basically means that anything here, if I have to type, means it will delete the rows. Means it will just view the rows, and this is a column. However, I don't want means minus the column part, so I just don't want that. And in case if I have to view now this, okay, my data, if I'm viewing this now, we can see I've got rid of that serial number as such. Now I will run a correlation on my data rather than on the my data one vector. Now I'm just running this correlation part. Now we can see that, you know, the correlation is not happening. So previously it was happening on the nominal data, but now as you can see, just sheer by the look of the data, we had an pre-assumption that, you know, somewhere height and weight are correlated, right? And you know, we can see here education qualification and age, somewhat they are related, but I can see, you know, IQ is 0.57 and house, okay, this is negative correlation, sorry. So somewhere education qualification and the IQ, even it is correlated, right? And now you can see here age has got a relationship, very strong relationship with the number of children and the household size. So however, I can tell by large that there is an aspect of multicollinearity in this, okay? So multicollinearity does exist, and in case if I have to check with the normality, okay. For the benefit of everyone, ma'am, what I will do is I'll just write the entire set of codes, ma'am. So however, I think so that machine learning algorithm, you know, somewhere I was not able to fulfill that when it came to the programming thing. Okay, so fundamentally I made an attempt to share my thoughts on that, But I will surely share this entire set of codes to the group. And further, the codes of KNN algorithm, naive-based theorem, and linear discriminant analysis with an example that I will also share. Man. So just last one attempt I would like to do, like in checking the MVN, man, multivariate normality, and so in this particular data set, so that is one option. However, you know, further for factor analysis, 3-4 lines of codes would be sufficient. These are the basic things what we are supposed to do, and like this, from here. Analysis from here. Okay, so like this, you know, multiple things will happen, whether the correlation exists, or else whether there is an aspect of multivariate normality, whether there is the data is normally distributed or no. So we will check that. For example, now we can see here all the data observations are normally distributed. That, you know, this particular data set was not normally distributed, but however, as the data set is a bit small, I'm going to say it's okay that in case if we don't convert this from a normal non-normal data to a normal data, it's fine. Okay, then also the algorithm, however, I think so I'm so my bad that I was not able to okay, I'll just want to state that, you know, at least we had a bit of understanding on, you know, how our programming looks like, and a few things on the fundamentals of factor analysis, how a concept actually what it means, and data mining algorithms as such, what are the different types of data mining algorithms. And each algorithm has got a prerequisite, and it's actually to be precise, it's not that complicated to execute these machine learning algorithms, because what I've observed in R is, like, for example, if I have to do a pie chart in MS Excel, it's very simple, but when it comes to R programming, I have to run some I have to write some 5 to 10 lines of codes for that. So somewhere a few things becomes a bit clumsy, but in case if I have to do a regression, just it takes only one line of code. So that is where R comes very handy. And I think so that's it from my side as of now, but I'll make sure that, you know, by today day end, I'll share the all the codes. I'll just type all the codes and I'll just share with madam. And by tomorrow, I think so it should reach to you all. So thank you very much, and thanks for your patience listening. Thank you very much.
With this, I want to thank Dr. Naveen Paul sir for conducting the data mining session using R, and sir has shared all the contents and the data sets what is required to execute the program. Now going ahead, you can just download whatever links we have sent, and sir will also share some resources. You can work on it. Thank you so much, sir, for this wonderful session and giving us insights about data mining using R. Thank you, sir.
Thank you.
Pleasure.